Good evening and welcome to our worship at home this evening. It's a great opportunity to come together and to worship our God in spirit and in truth. We enjoy worshiping on the weekends, but this midweek is meant for a time of family togetherness. We come to you from our homes to share with you the readings and song and to encourage each other. I hope that these evenings do just that. A couple of guidance items. One is that I hope that you're able to, in your home, create a little bit of a home altar, a place that you could set aside to give honor and glory and worship to our God. Also, I hope you have a hymnal. This hymnal we're going to always use week in and week out as our form of prayer and praise to God and singing hymns. If you need one, stop by the church office and check one out. If you have your own, wonderful. And last but not least, if you can continue to be generous to our ministries at Galley, especially during this time, feel free to mail in your offering, your tithe, to drop it off the church office, or to do it electronically through our website. May the Lord bless your worship this evening. Thank you. We'll continue then with our opening versicles. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. From the rising of the sun to its setting, the name of the Lord is to be praised. Better is one day in your courts than a thousand elsewhere. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than dwell in the tents of the wicked. Make me to know your ways, O Lord. Teach me your paths. Sanctify us in your truth. Your word is truth. From the rising of the sun to its setting, the name of the Lord is to be praised. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. As it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
The Lord God is my strength and my song, and He has become my salvation. With joy will you draw water from the wells of salvation.
Today's reading comes from Judges chapter 3, verses 7 through 31. It's a very challenging text. And the people of Israel did what is evil in the sight of the Lord. They forgot the Lord their God and served the Baals and the Asheroth. Therefore, the anger of the Lord was kindled against Israel, and he sold them into the hand of Cushan-Rishathaim, king of Mesopotamia. And the people of Israel served Cushan-Rishathaim 8 years. But when the people of Israel cried out to the Lord raised up a deliverer for the people of Israel who saved them, Othniel, the son of Kenaz, Caleb's younger brother. The Spirit of the Lord was upon him, and he judged Israel. He went out to war, and the Lord gave Cushan-Rishathaim, king of Mesopotamia, into his hand. And his hand prevailed over Cushan-Rishathaim. So the land had rest 40 years. Then Othniel, the son of Kenaz, died. And the people of Israel again did what is evil in the sight of the Lord. And the Lord strengthened Eglon, the king of Moab, against Israel, because they had done what was evil in the sight of the Lord. He gathered to himself the Ammonites and the Amalekites and went and defeated Israel. And they took possession of the city of palms, and the people of Israel served Eglon, the king of Moab, 18 years. Then the people of Israel cried out to the Lord, and the Lord raised up for them a deliverer, Ehud, the son of Gera, the Benjaminite, a left-handed man. The people of Israel sent tribute by him to Eglon, the king of Moab. And Ehud made for himself a sword with two edges, a cubit in length, and he bound it on his right thigh under his clothes. And he presented the tribute to Eglon, king of Moab. Now, Eglon was a very fat man. And when Ehud had finished presenting the tribute, he sent away the people who carried the tribute. But he himself turned back at the idols near Gilgal and said, "I have a secret message for you, O king." And he commanded silence, and all his attendants went out from his presence. And Ehud came to him as he was sitting alone in his cool roof chamber. And Ehud said, "I have a message from God for you." And he arose from his seat, and Ehud reached with his left hand, took the sword from his right thigh, and thrust it into his belly. And the hilt also went in after the blade, and the fat closed over the blade, for he did not pull the sword out of his belly, and the dung came out. Then Ehud went out into the porch and closed the doors of the roof chamber behind him and locked them. When he had gone, the servants came, and when they saw that the doors of the roof chamber were locked, they thought, "Surely he is relieving himself in the closet of the cool chamber." And they waited till they were embarrassed. But when he still did not open the doors of the roof chamber, they took the key and opened them, and there lay their lord dead on the floor. Ehud escaped while they delayed, and he passed beyond the idols and escaped to Sarah. When he arrived, he sounded the trumpet in the hill country of Ephraim. Then the people of Israel went down with him from the hill country, and he was their leader. And he said to them, "Follow after me, for the Lord has given your enemies, the Moabites, into your hands." So they went down after him and seized the fords of the Jordan against the Moabites and did not allow anyone to pass over. And they killed at that time about 10,000 of the Moabites, all strong, able-bodied men. Not a man escaped. So Moab was subdued that day under the hand of Israel, and the land had rest for 80 years. After him was Shamgar, the son of Anath, who killed 600 of the Philistines with an ox goad, and he also saved Israel. Here ends the reading.
Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God.
You were awesome. You were so good.
The second reading is from Acts 13, verses 42 to 52. As they went out, the people begged that these things might be told to them the next Sabbath. And after the meeting of the synagogue broke up, many Jews and devout converts to Judaism followed Paul and Barnabas, who, as they spoke with them, urged them to continue in the grace of God. The next Sabbath, almost the whole city gathered to hear the word of the Lord. But when the Jews saw the crowds, they were filled with jealousy and began to contradict what was spoken by Paul, reviling him. And Paul and Barnabas spoke out boldly, saying, "It is necessary that the word of God be spoken to you first. Since you thrust it aside and judge yourselves unworthy of eternal life, behold, we are turning to the Gentiles. For so the Lord has commanded us, saying, 'I have made you a light for the Gentiles, that you might bring salvation to the ends of the earth.' And when the Gentiles heard this, they began rejoicing and glorifying the word of the Lord, and as many as were appointed to eternal life believed. And the word of the Lord was spreading throughout the whole region. But the Jews inside of the devout woman of high standing and the leading men of the city stirred up persecution against Paul and Barnabas and drove them out of their district. But they shook off the dust from their feet against them and went to Iconium. And the disciples were filled with joy and with the Holy Spirit. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks,
Rita. I don't know.
This is the responsive reading from the hymnal, page 263. And if anybody has hymnaletum, you could use it.
Forever alone, Lord, your word is firmly set in the heavens.
Lord, I love the habitation of your house and the place where your glory dwells.
Blessed are those who hear the word of the Lord and keep it.
Lord, I love the habitation of your house and the place where your glory dwells.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Lord, I love the habitation of your house and the place where your glory dwells.
Good evening, and it is a warm, warm evening. The puppies are out here with me as I get to share the catechism lesson with you this evening. Our catechism readings are from the first commandment and its meaning, the close of the commandments and its meaning, as well as the sixth and seventh petition of the Lord's Prayer. The first commandment, you shall have no other gods. What does this mean? We should fear, love, and trust in God above all things. And then we get to the close of the commandments. What does God say about all these commandments? He says in Exodus 20, verses 5 and 6, I, the Lord, your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for the sin of the fathers to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing love to 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. What does this mean? God threatens to punish all who break these commandments. Therefore, we should fear his wrath and do not do anything against them. But he promises grace and every blessing to all who keep these commandments. Therefore, we should also love and trust in him and gladly do what he commands. Next, the sixth and seventh petition of the Lord's Prayer. And lead us not into temptation. What does this mean? God tempts no one. We pray in this petition that God would guard and keep us, so the devil, the world, and our sinful nature may not deceive us or mislead us into false belief, despair, and other great shame and vice. Although we are attacked by these things, we pray that we may finally overcome them and win the victory. The seventh petition, but deliver us from evil. What does this mean? We pray in this petition, in summary, that our Father in heaven would rescue us from every evil of body and soul, possessions and reputation. And finally, when our last hour comes, give us a blessed end and graciously take us from this valley of sorrow to himself in heaven. Have a wonderful evening. And the dogs have gone in because it's a warm day out here. God bless. Aloha.
Good evening, everyone. Let's begin in a time of prayer. Tonight's prayer I actually found just a few verses from Deuteronomy. It's from chapter 32, verses 1 through 3. Give ear, O heavens, and I will speak, and let the earth hear the words of my mouth. May my teaching drop as the rain, my speech distill as the new, like gentle rain upon the tender grass, and like showers upon the herb. For I will proclaim the name of the Lord, ascribe greatness in our God. Amen. So, thanks for joining us again this evening. I wanted to just kind of share one of those little stories from my childhood. As most of you know by now, I grew up Catholic, and I remember attending the Catholic Mass, and there was a specific hymn that we would always sing that was part of the order of service. Now, the order of service is just a very concise term to explain the specific order in which things happen during the service. Nearly all Christian organizations, excuse me, I have a little sweat in my eye here, all Christian organizations have one posted somewhere on their main website. So if you're interested and want to see where, you know, how other denominations do what they do, you can go look them up. But the hymn that we sang every week, it was a very brief hymn, and it's called the Roman Missal, and it's spelled M-I-S-S-A-L. And of course, being a kid, I always used to think of missile, like projectiles, with little Pope hats on top of them. It's just what kids do. But the hymn only has 10 words. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. And as a child, and even into my adult years, still attending the Catholic services, I would often think about what I was supposed to do between the risen part and the come again part, and I didn't really know. Thankfully, the apostles have written an entire book to give us a little bit of guidance, as well as a little bit of insight as to how the ministry of the early church went, and that is what we're going to look at tonight, is the book of Acts. So it's not just written about the good works of the apostles. Martin Luther actually makes a very powerful observation about this particular book, and he says on his epistle, it's not only about the preaching of the apostles, but it also explains how we are justified through the gospel, the good news alone, without the law. So tonight's reading, it began with, or begins and ends, with two very powerful verses. So let's set the scene. We are try that again. Tonight's reading begins and ends with two very powerful verses, but let's set the scene here. So Paul and Barnabas, they are heading to, or they're in rather, Antioch of Pisidia, which is in kind of the southwest section of Turkey. It's central southwest. And they're at the synagogue, and Paul is sharing some words of encouragement with the people. So they are about ready to set out and continue their journey onto Iconium. And tonight's text, it began with verse 42. As they went out, the people begged that those things might be told to them the next Sabbath. The people begged. Those words are something I personally never thought I'd ever think I'd need to say in my lifetime. Begging for the word, begging for the sacraments, for communal fellowship. We live in America, and we're constitutionally guaranteed these rights by our government. Why would I ever think that I would not be allowed to go do these things, these same things I've been doing for as long as I can remember, in my own country? And at the beginning of this COVID season we're in, I was begging the Lord to grant us relief from the pandemic so that we may again fellowship, share the sacrament of the word and the Lord's Supper as a community, and to do it safely. And it seems like my prayers are slowly being answered, but again, God works on his time and definitely not ours. So back in the text now, Paul and Barnabas, they're going out. Many Jews and devout converts to Judaism followed Paul and Barnabas, who, as they spoke with them, urged them to continue in the grace of God. They're building the foundation of a church right here in Pisidian Antioch and encouraging the Jews and the converts to spread the word. As they gathered the following Sabbath, and remember Sabbath is always on Saturdays in Judaism, almost the whole city gathered here to hear the word of the Lord. Whenever I read this verse, and I've read this verse several times, whenever I read this verse, my thoughts often lead me to think of the large gatherings that occur at Vatican City when the Pope speaks Mass to the large crowds there. And estimates of the population of the city of Pisidia and Antioch at this time, there were, and with the surrounding villages, was about 50,000 people. So very much what you can fit into Vatican City. And many had gathered at the synagogue here to hear the word of the Lord. You know, we think it's a spectacle to see now, but that was 2,000 years ago. There wasn't TV or anything else to kind of coach us along in that thought. So just imagine what that looked like. So our good disciple Paul, he teaches in the synagogue, and unfortunately some of the Jews became jealous and began to contradict what was spoken by Paul, reviling him. This was not uncommon during the time. Many first century Jews would often become violent or belligerent when they were approached about Christ. This is very much the same behavior that Christ witnessed himself, and it's recorded in all four books of the Gospels. So nonetheless, Paul and Barnabas, they do as they had been instructed by Christ, and they tell the Jews and the crowds, it was necessary that the word of God be spoken first to you, since you thrust it aside and judge yourself unworthy of eternal life. Behold, we are turning to the Gentiles. For the Lord has commanded us, saying, I have made you a light for the Gentiles, that you may bring salvation to the ends of the earth. Paul and Barnabas, in these two lines, lay it all on the line for the crowd. they make a summation of Christ's teaching of sharing the word with the Jews first and then the Gentiles. In this act, they declare they are fulfilling the law that Christ gave them. So what happens next? Well, what happens next is what we would hope would happen, and then what we would expect to happen. So in verses 48 and 49, it is written, "And when the Gentiles heard this, they began rejoicing and glorifying the word of the Lord. And as many were appointed to eternal life, believed. And the word of the Lord was spreading throughout the whole region." These Gentiles, who had never been given a promise of eternal life before this moment, have now been chosen in that moment. They have become the called children of Jesus Christ and set apart to have everlasting life as they began to spread the good news with their neighbors. They have been written into the book of life. I would think that this is what we would have hoped when Paul chose such a bold tactic. And to be honest with you, what happened here is very much a recurring theme throughout the book of Acts. The good news, and if you remember a couple weeks ago, I taught you a little Greek, the euangelios. The good news carries on. So now we get to the part where we figure what would happen. So it's verse 50. It reads, "But the Jews incited the devout women of high standing and the leading men of the city, stirred up persecution against Paul and Barnabas, and drove them out of their district. They became jealous. They let the work of sin take hold of them. They have their hearts hardened, and they drive out Paul and Barnabas by persecuting them." Persecution was very much the way of life in early Christianity. There are countless stories of leaders in the church who would be persecuted, imprisoned, even executed. These men and women, surrounded by non-believers, scolded and outcast for their beliefs, and eventually they would meet their demise because of their belief. Jesus told his followers repeatedly that they would be met with persecution. They would be attacked verbally and physically because someone disagreed with their beliefs and their religious practice. They were outcasts because they followed a man who gave them a promise of the afterlife. Even in his waning moments of his earthly life, Christ tells the criminal that was crucified with him on the cross, "Truly, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise." The promise of everlasting life, even for the Gentiles. And doing it in that moment when you're about to give up your own life. And in their final act against the Jews in Pisidian Antioch, "But they shook off the dust from their feet against them and went to Iconium. They turned the other cheek, and the disciples were filled with joy and with the Holy Spirit." Paul and Barnabas delivered the good news to the people of Pisidian and Antioch at the direction of Christ Jesus. He tells the disciples in Mark 16:15, "Go into all the world and proclaim the gospel to the whole of creation." The good news Paul and Barnabas shared with the crowd this day, even with the Gentiles, even the Gentiles will have eternal life through Jesus Christ if they believe. And that's all it takes to receive the salvation offered to us by God. Going all the way back to the book of Genesis with Abram, who becomes Abraham. Abram was told he would have offspring greater than the number of the stars in the sky. And he believed the Lord, and he counted it to him as righteousness. God made a promise, and he kept it. And that's what he does. He does this because of his mercy and his grace, brought to the fullness through Christ, through his crucifixion, his death, and his resurrection. God makes a promise in the Old Testament and keeps them time after time. He promised us a Redeemer, and that was given to us through the blood and the body and the flesh of Jesus Christ. Tonight's New Testament, again, truly gives us a brief glimpse of what the early church endured. Jealousy, lies, persecution, being run out of town. But the power in the truth of what they taught and the strength of the Holy Spirit led them to convert so many followers time and time again. Even in the face of persecution and ultimately their deaths, they did not disavow what they were teaching. And the disciples were filled with joy and the Holy Spirit. It's easy to want to give up when someone discourages your ministry, whether it be in person, online, via social media. People in this world who are unbelievers will say and do a lot to get a believer to stop sharing their Christocentric message. That Christocentric message that we share with, which is the unending bond of truth between the Old Testament and the New Testament. That promise of everlasting life and salvation in the eyes of the Lord. So we do as we're told, not only here today, tonight, but as we're told in the good news of Luke, we take up our cross, we follow Jesus as he told us. And wherever they do not receive you, when you leave that town, shake the dust from your feet as a testimony against them. Know that regardless of where that place may be, Christ will be there with you. You will be filled with joy, and you will be filled with the Holy Spirit. In Christ's precious name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
us in the prayers for this day. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy.
For the gift of divine peace and of pardon, with all our heart and with all our mind, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the Holy Christian Church here and scattered throughout the world, and for the proclamation of the gospel and calling of all to faith, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this nation, for our cities and communities, and for the common welfare of us all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy. For seasonable weather and for the fruitfulness of the earth, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy.
For those who labor, for those who work and is difficult or dangerous, and for all who travel, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all those in need, for the hungry and homeless, for the widowed and orphan, and for all those in prison, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the sick and the dying, and for all those who care for them, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy. For all those in our church family and our homes, as well as those who are scattered abroad in need of our prayers and petitions on this day, that we now lift up to you, Lord, in the silence of our hearts. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy.
Finally, for these and for all our needs of body and soul, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Blessed Lord, you have caused all holy scriptures to be written for our learning. Grant that we may so hear them, read, mark, and learn, and take them to heart, that by the patience and comfort of your holy word, we may embrace and ever hold fast the blessed hope of everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. I thank you, my heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, your dear Son, that you have graciously kept me this day, and I pray that you would forgive me all my sins where I have done wrong, and graciously keep me this night. For into your hands I commend myself, my body and soul, and all things. Let your holy angel be with me, that the evil foe may have no power over me. Amen. Conclude with the blessing. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. Now may the Almighty and merciful Lord, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit bless and preserve you. Amen. Amen. Have a wonderful evening, and may peace be with you.
As they went out, the people begged that these things
Acts 13. The second reading is from Acts 13. Acts 13.
I always thought it was funny that it sounded like missile, like projectile.